Well, have you guys ever been to this place where you've done something a certain way for quite a while, and then you hear of something or someone who does it better than you? And you think, when you hear about this better way of doing things, you think, wow, why didn't I think of that before? There's a better way to do it. It's not this way. There's a better way. Well, my wife had this happen to her a few years ago, and I've got her permission to share this story because it's not in the best light of her. See, we purchased these small cast iron frying pans, and they were perfect for cooking a couple of eggs. And they also came with this box, and in the box was these hot pads. But they're not like the square hot pads that you get. They were like these mitten hot pads. And they were about this tall and like this skinny. And they looked perfect just to slide on the handle of the frying pan so that when you go to pick up the frying pan, because it's cast iron, you don't burn yourself on the handle. So it's just like these mittens. Well, my wife, when she saw them, she didn't know what they were for. And so the rest of the family were using these hot pads the proper way. My wife put them on her fingers like this. And she's grabbing the frying pan like this, trying to lift it up to think like, well, this must be the way you use it. And she didn't know that there was a better way until my son came along and said, you know, you just put it on the handle and then you pick it up. And she's like, ah, the light bulb goes off. And now it makes sense. So there's a better way to do things. See, this is what the author's getting at in chapter 8 here. For the last few chapters, the author of the book of Hebrews has been talking about Jesus as our high priest. And last week, he made some very strong arguments as to why this is a really big deal. Now, this week, he's getting to close off his writing about Jesus as our high priest, and he's going to move on to the new covenant. And the new covenant is the better way. It's the better way. And the author is going to show us why it's the better way in this passage. And the author of Hebrews, he's telling us about how God brought in this better way, and he shook things up because the old way was done. When Jesus died on the cross, he brought into power the new covenant. And through that covenant, God changed mankind, and he wrote his law on their hearts and on their minds. And through that act, we can freely and easily know God, we can understand his ways, and we can have the power to live for God. See, when the new covenant came into play, desires changed from the inside out. You were able to live different. People desired to live pleasing to God instead of striving to follow a written law. And that happened because God's law is written now on our hearts and our minds of his people. Well, let's look. Verse 1 and 2. It says, now this is the main point of the things we are saying. We have such a high priest who is seated at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens, a minister of the sanctuary and of the true tabernacle which the Lord erected and not man. The author's saying here, this is the main point of the book of Hebrews. This is what he's been trying to explain to us for the last seven chapters. Jesus is our high priest, and he's seated now at the right hand of God. And this high priest, the one that lived a life as a man, he died a cruel death. He was the sacrifice for our sins. He didn't need to bring a sacrifice because he was the sacrifice. And he rose to new life after he died to take up his place on the throne. Therefore, Jesus is greater. And that's the point that we've been trying to make. And I really like the word majesty here because it describes God so well. And I think we'll be in complete awe and wonder at the sight of the greatness of God, just how majestic he is. I think if you had a glimpse of God or into the heavenlies, you'd be a different person right now. You'd live different. Your priorities would shift. You'd treat people differently if you saw a glimpse of the majesty in heaven. And notice where Jesus is. He's there. He's in the throne room. And he's seated in the throne room. And what we're going to see as we move on is that the throne room in heaven is like it's like the tabernacle or the temple would have looked like back in these Old Testament days. In the Old Testament, the tabernacle, the temple, didn't have seats in them. There was no place to sit down for the priests because the priests were supposed to be working. They were busy. Their work was never, ever finished. When they were on duty, they were supposed to be working. They were sacrificing for people's sins. Because people sin all the time, the work of the priest is pretty busy. So there's no chairs for them to sit down. People would be continually coming to the tabernacle with an offering for sins. The priests continually are sacrificing animals. Blood was spilled daily, first so people of Israel could see the weight of their sin. If you saw this animal being sacrificed because of you, because of the things that you did, that would make you want to do something different, not live that way. Secondly, so that their sin could be covered, so they could be made right with God. They were following the law. That's why all these sacrifices. But it says Jesus is now sitting in heaven. And this shows us that when Jesus said on the cross, it is finished, he meant it. The payments, all the payments are done. Everything's been paid for. It's final. It's complete. No more payments are necessary because Jesus has paid it all. Therefore, when he ascended to heaven, he went to his rightful place. Beside the throne of the majesty, he sat down because his work was finished. Unlike all the priests of the old, whose work was never finished, Jesus is done. And the author reiterates here just how awesome Jesus is, and we have such an amazing high priest because of these things. And it says that Jesus is the minister of the sanctuary of the true tabernacle. And what we're going to see here in verses 3 to 5 is that the true tabernacle is in heaven. The one on earth is just a copy of the one in heaven. Let's look at it. Verse 3. It says, "For every high priest is appointed to offer both gifts and sacrifices. Therefore, it's necessary that this one also have something to offer. For if he were on earth, he would not be a priest, since there are priests who offer the gifts according to the law, who serve the copy and shadow of the heavenly things, as Moses was divinely instructed when he was about to make the tabernacle. For he said, 'See that you make all things according to the pattern shown you on this mountain.'" What the author's saying is that the priest on duty would offer both gifts and sacrifices. And he's saying if Jesus is our high priest, he should have something to offer as well. And we all know, because we taught it for the last few weeks, Jesus offered himself. He was the sacrifice. Therefore, that made Jesus very uniquely equipped for his role as our high priest. And verse 4 reiterates that Jesus is our unique high priest because he didn't serve as a priest here on earth. Well, why? Now, I'm sure there were skeptics at the time that this letter was written, and the author's trying to answer some of those questions. People probably said, if Jesus is our high priest, how come he didn't serve in the temple? How come he wasn't there making sacrifices? Well, verse 5 tells us the tabernacle and the temple are just a shadow or a copy of the real thing. The real thing's in heaven. The copy was here on earth, furthering his point that it would not have been right for Jesus, our great high priest, to serve in the temple here on earth, because what was here at the time is only a copy. Jesus is the real deal. Therefore, Jesus shouldn't be ministering in the copy. He should be ministering in the true one, the real one. It'd be like asking Sidney Crosby in the NHL to go back to the junior hockey league. Like, leave the NHL and go back to the junior hockey league. You'd be foolish. The author's making the point that Jesus is greater. Therefore, proving the point that Jesus should not serve in the copy made by man, but in the real one made by God. One commentary says, not only is Jesus himself better than the Levitical priesthood, but the work Jesus has been given to do is far superior to theirs, since the place where they serve is only a copy or a shadow of the heavenly original. And see, God was very serious about this copy that Moses was supposed to make. He wanted it to be well done. That's why it says at the end of verse 5 here, "See that you make all things according to the pattern shown you on this mountain." Quoting Exodus 25, God gave Moses a pattern for the tabernacle. And you can read all about it for many chapters in the book of Exodus. And many of you, I know you've read it in your own devotions, and you've wondered why. Why is there so much detail here in the book of Exodus about this tabernacle? Why is there all these measurements? Why does it have to be exact? Well, but God wanted it to be exact because it's a picture of what you're going to see in heaven. That's why there's all this attention to details. And when we get to Hebrews chapter 9, it describes the tabernacle just a little bit for us. It talks about the lampstand or the menorah, the table of showbread, the incense altar, and then finally the Holy of Holies, the place where God dwells. And we'll get to those in detail, but the difference between the tabernacle Moses made on earth and the one in heaven is the curtain, the veil, it's gone. Separating the Holy of Holies, it's not there in heaven because Jesus brought complete access to God. In the Holy of Holies is God and Jesus, our representative, our high priest, the one who sealed the deal of this new covenant for us. Let's look at it. What is this new covenant? It says, "But now he has obtained a more excellent ministry, inasmuch as he is also mediator of a better covenant, which was established on better promises." See, Jesus has obtained a more excellent ministry, it says. And this ministry or job is that of a mediator of this better covenant. First of all, the word mediator means this, one who intervenes between two, either in order to make or restore peace or friendship or to bring about a contract. So it's one who stands in the middle and brings two parties together. People were maybe not seeing eye to eye. And perhaps you've done this with friends. You've been a mediator with friends. Maybe you've been a peacemaker. Maybe there's two parties. They just can't see eye to eye on a certain thing. Or they're trying to make this deal, or the relationship is at odds. And you come in between those two people and you intervene on their behalf and you bring them together. You mediate for them. And this was the job of Jesus. He's the mediator between two parties. You got holy God and you have sinful man. And Jesus Christ is the mediator in the middle. God's like, hey, I love all these people, but I'm holy, and no sin can be in my presence. I have standards. I've laid them all out for all of you guys. Anyone that doesn't measure up to those standards, you can't come into heaven. I can't be near you, but I love all these people. And sinful man is like, how could I ever reach God? I wish I met all these standards, but I keep on sinning. And if I lived, I think if people lived pre-Christ days, they'd probably say, there's got to be something easier than all these sacrifices. Jesus is the mediator. Jesus is the way. He mediates between these two parties. So Jesus, the mediator, comes out of heaven, becomes like man. He lives as a man without sin, and he was a sacrifice for our sins. And that all who believe in him are now made right with God, because God sees the sacrifice of Jesus as payment for our sins. Now the two parties can come together, because the blocker, which was sin, has been dealt with by the mediator. It's been taken care of. It's off the table. Then it says that Jesus is the mediator of a better covenant, a better covenant. Well, the covenant, what's the covenant? It means disposition or simply final arrangement or contract. It says Jesus is the mediator of this better covenant. Now, why is it better? Well, it's better because it's based on what God has done for you. Not on what you have done for God, but it's based on what God has done for you. It's not based on how you keep the contract. This new covenant is better because it's based on God's faithfulness, God's love, God's mercy, and it's sealed with the blood of Jesus Christ. Now, we celebrate the new communion, or we celebrate the new covenant when we take communion. Jesus says, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you. Jesus is saying his blood is bringing about a new covenant. The mediator is sealing the deal of the new covenant with his blood. Just like the old covenant was through the shed blood of animals. So the new covenant is through the shed blood of Jesus, his sacrifice. Jesus is the mediator of this better covenant, and it says it was established or built upon by better promises. So here's the new covenant, and it's built on better promises. Just like a house is built on a concrete foundation. If you build a house upon a foundation, it's going to stand strong. Or pilings. You know pilings when they build a bridge? There's building this overpass by COP or by Winsport, and you can see this massive machine hammering in these big iron posts into the ground, or the steel posts, whatever they are, and it's just like day and night, it's hammering these posts into the ground really, really deep, so that this bridge is very secure, very strong, and very stable. The deeper they go, the more stable it is. And so this bridge is strong and stable. Just like the new covenant, it's built upon promises of God. This covenant is built on top of the promises. The promises of God act as the foundation or the pilings to make it very secure and very strong. Now we're going to get to the specifics of those promises in the new covenant in verses 7 to 13, but I just want to take a moment and talk about the promises of God. God's promises to you should act as a foundation for your life. Your life in Jesus is built upon the promises found in the Bible. And that you should, they should act as a foundation, and they should be able to keep you sturdy, stable, and secure. Your relationship with Jesus is built on top of these promises. And these promises are strong and secure. They're not going to budge. They're not going to move. They're not going to change. And the promises of God, they're more secure than the chair that you're sitting on right now. You all sat down. You probably didn't even think about if the chair would hold you up. You just sat down. But the chair's holding you up. You trust it. Your full weight is on that chair right now. But God's promises are more real and more secure than that chair. Well, some of these promises, I'm going to move through a list of some of these promises, and I encourage you to look up these promises in the Bible. It's like medicine for your soul when you read these things. It provides exactly what you need when you're reminded once again how much you're loved and how much you truly have as a Christian. I mean, Romans 1, verse 16 to 17, John 3, 16, God's promise salvation to anyone who believes in him. That's huge. You don't have to go to hell. You can go to heaven, God's salvation for everybody. 2 Corinthians 5:17, you're a new creation in Jesus Christ. You're not the same as you were. You're new, you're better, you're different. Deuteronomy 4:29, if we search for God, you're going to find him. God's not playing hide and seek. You just search and you're going to find him. He's right there. Romans 8:28, all things work together for good to those who love God. God's got it. It's in his hands. He's going to take care of you. Why? Because he loves you. 2 Corinthians 1, 3 and 4, God brings you comfort in the midst of trials. God brings you comfort. And if you need comfort in trials, go to God and he will provide it. 1 Peter 3, 4, I love this one. Your inheritance is reserved for you in heaven. Heaven, there's a place in heaven for you. And it's got your name on it. When you get there, it's going to say Matt or Joe or whatever your name is. When you get there, and you're going to feel so special because it's reserved in heaven for you. Philippians 4, 6, and 7, promised peace when we pray. Anxiety goes away. I did this morning. I woke up this morning and I was feeling anxious about things. And I prayed and I said, Lord, your word says that when I pray, anxiety should go away. So take it away. Guess what? He took it away. It was gone. I felt way better. Philippians 4, 19, Matthew 6, 33, God will provide for you. He's going to feed you. He's going to make sure you have clothes. He's going to make sure you have food and a place to stay. God will provide for you. It's a promise. Matthew 11, 28, Jesus promises rest for you right here, right now. And some of us are all so busy running around like crazy, and we don't have any rest in our minds or in our hearts. We're just running around, but Jesus promises rest to those who come to him. Now, some of us, now that's not an exhaustive list of the promises. That's just some of them. But some of us, you know these promises. You've heard these promises. And some of us, we've heard them so many times, they've actually become stale in your mind. Let me ask you, do you really know these promises? Like, there's knowing, but do you know these promises? See, I find these promises get driven deeper and deeper and deeper into our hearts when we need them to be real to us. When you're crying out to God for him to show you his faithfulness, it seems like you're barely hanging on in this moment and you're desperate for something to change and you're praying to God, please change this. But then it breaks. The sun comes out and you realize that the promise is true and God did it. It's an amazing time. You actually see that you weren't actually hanging on to this edge of this cliff, but you're in the palm of God's hand. Praise God. Now I know that some of you here, you have a difficult time trusting in these promises, believing that they're true, believing that they're going to be real for you in your life. And sometimes in your lives, you actually trust the chair that you're sitting in more than you trust in the promises of God. But God's promises are the most secure thing that you have in life. The most secure thing. It's not your bank account. Well, if I have 3 months of savings in there, I'm secure. That's not as secure as the promises of God. It's not your mortgage is paid off. My mortgage is gone. I can live for free. That's great. No, not in relationships or friendships. The promises of God are the most secure thing ever. And sometimes you just need to dwell on those promises and realize just how much you have in Jesus Christ. And the author is going to get into that here. He's going to show us how much we have through the work of Jesus bringing in this new covenant for us. Verse 7. For if that first covenant had been faultless, then no place would have been sought for a second. Yesterday, I went out and I bought some new running shoes. My old ones were totally worn out. They were done. They had too many kilometers on them. The grips were flat. There was no grip. The cushioning was gone. My knees started to get sore when I was running. And so they were just done. They needed to be replaced. They were done. So I went out and bought some new ones. And that's what the author's saying here. The first covenant is done. It needs to be replaced. Now, remember who he's writing to. Jewish believers who are in danger of leaving their faith in Jesus and going back to a works-based Judaism. And he's made the point very clear. He's been really driving it home for the last few chapters that Jesus is our high priest and Jesus is far greater than anything else. And now he's establishing that Jesus has brought this new covenant for us. Last week we saw the law. It makes nothing perfect, right? The law gives you the standard. It shows you the expectation, but it doesn't give you any power to keep the law. It doesn't make you perfect. It simply shows you that there's a problem. We saw it last week. But the ultimate problem with the law, the ultimate problem is me. I'm the problem. You're the problem with the law. You're the problem with the old covenant. It's us. We won't keep the law. The problem is the people. They don't keep their end of the deal. And let's see what it says in verse 8 and 9. It says, because finding fault with them, he says, behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel, with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they did not continue in my covenant. And I disregarded them, says the Lord. What this tells us is that people are the problem. It says, because finding fault with them, the people couldn't keep their end of the deal. And maybe you've read it, Exodus chapter 19. This is when the first covenant was made. You can read it after the service. But it's phrased like this in verse 5. God speaking says, now therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, then you shall be a special treasure to me above all people, for the earth is mine. And in verse 8, this is the children of Israel's response. And they say, all that the Lord has spoken, we will do. They agreed to their end of the deal. But did they follow through with their end of the deal? No, they did not. And neither would we. We wouldn't do it. See, the majority of the Old Testament is patient, loving God, trying to get the Israelites to follow him, but they don't. And after the covenant was made in Exodus 19, Moses goes up this mountain. There's an earthquake, and there's smoke, and there's lightning and fire, and it's just this incredible scene when God is writing the Ten Commandments for Moses. And all the while, the children of Israel are doing what? They're making a golden calf to worship this calf, saying, this is your God. 40 days after they made this covenant with God, 40 days, that's it. It's a really far swing in the opposite direction. The first covenant didn't work because the people didn't continue in it. You can read through the Old Testament, the prophets. You can read the prophets begging Israel to change, saying, come on, change. And this went on for hundreds of years. God sees Israel in sin. God sends a prophet to help them. The people sometimes sort of listen, and sometimes, most of the time, they reject the prophet, and they don't listen. And for hundreds of years, God also watches kings come and go. Some do good, and they follow God, yay. But the majority, they do evil, and they turn the people away from God. Chuck Misler says this, note that God does not find fault with the old covenant, but with the people themselves. The law is spiritual, but men are carnal, sold under sin. The law was weak through the flesh. In other words, the failure of Israel could not be blamed on any weakness in the old covenant, but on the weakness of human nature. It is here that grace steps in, and what the law could not do because of man's weakness, God accomplished through the cross. And David Guzik also says, you see, the law can do many things. It can guide us, it can teach us, it can tell us about God's character, but the law cannot give energy to our flesh. It can give us the standard, but it can't give us power to live pleasing to God. And the author goes on in this passage here, and he quotes a very familiar passage from Jeremiah chapter 31 to talk about this new covenant. And Jeremiah was prophesying of the day that Jesus would die on the cross for the sins of the world and usher in this new covenant of grace. And so Jeremiah is prophesying that God is bringing a new covenant, not like the one God made with their fathers when he led them out of Egypt. He's bringing this new covenant because the Israelites didn't continue in the old covenant. They didn't stick to their end of the deal. So it says these words, I disregarded them. Now, these words are a bit of a sticking point for some people. Sounds kind of harsh. But if you look at the original quote in Jeremiah, you can do it after. It doesn't say I disregarded them. It says I was a husband to them. So it's a bit of a different feel, isn't it? Two different phrases. I was a husband to them versus I disregarded them. Why the change? Well, scholars think the author of Hebrews is quoting the Septuagint, which is the Greek translation of the Old Testament. So he had a copy of the Greek translation of the Old Testament out as he's writing this letter, and he's copying it out from the Septuagint. And I think either version is fine. It's biblical, and it lines up with the rest of Scripture because, one hand, you have God being like a husband to the Israelites. He cared for them. He gave them what they needed. He was patient with them. You can read through the book of Hosea. You can hear the teaching we did on it. You can see this picture of a husband lovingly waiting for a wayward wife, forgiving her once again for all the sin that she does, and waiting for her to return home. It's a picture of God with the Israelites. On the other hand, God disregarded them. They broke the covenant, so the deal was off. If people disregard God for many, many, many years, and God gives them multiple chances through those years to keep the covenant, to come back to him, to keep their end of the deal, he sends prophets to warn them, he's patient with them, but they continue to disregard God, and they don't follow his ways, in turn, he disregards them. You made your choice, it's very clear. Go ahead, walk away. I'm not going to pursue. And instead, he brings this new covenant, a better covenant. The old way is done. The new way is better, and it's coming in. And let's see what this says, the new way. Verse 10 to 11, or 10 to 12. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will write them on their hearts. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. None of them shall teach his neighbor, and none his brother, saying, know the Lord. For all shall know me, and the least of them to the greatest of them. For I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and their lawless deeds I will remember no more. Notice it says, I will make. God will make this covenant. And God will keep this covenant. See, the new covenant says, I will make. Instead of being, if you will. Remember when we quoted Exodus 19? God said to the Israelites, if you will keep the covenant, then blessings and so on, etc. The new covenant is better because it's not based on us keeping the covenant. It's not based on us. It's based on God keeping the covenant. God says, I will make. God's saying, he's making this covenant. He's the keeper of this covenant. He's writing it. He's going to make sure it happens. Now, these are the specific promises found here. He's promising through the prophet Jeremiah that God's law will be put in your heart and in your mind. He will be your God, and they will be his people. All people will know the Lord. God will be merciful for the sins and the lawless deeds, and he's not going to remember those things anymore. I remember reading this passage when I first got saved and thinking, this is awesome. This is so cool because I was living it at that time. Maybe you know what I'm talking about. You felt God's law being written on your heart and your mind. You had different desires. Your desires were changing. You wanted to be different because God's law, there's a change on the inside. And how does God's law get written into someone's heart? It's through the work of the Holy Spirit. See, when I first got saved, I knew there was a change in my life. And once I got saved, I thought differently about things. I desired different things. And many of you have experienced that. God's law was written on your heart and your mind when you got saved. Instead of in the old covenant, the law is written on these stone tablets. They're now written on your flesh, inside of you. And the Holy Spirit, he came after Jesus died. You can read the promise of it in John chapter 16. And in verse 7, Jesus says this, it is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the helper will not come to you. But if I depart, I will send him to you. And Jesus then went on to explain the work of the Holy Spirit. The job of the Holy Spirit is to convict the world of sin or righteousness or judgment. And the Spirit will guide you into truth. It'll teach you these things, and the Spirit will glorify Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit in us is God's law written on your heart and your mind. Therefore, as believers, you know the truth. You know when something is wrong because the Holy Spirit is there to tell you, remind you of it. He's there to help you live it properly. He gives you the strength to live these things out. I was brought to the reality of the law being around and changing my actions. See, knowing the law, when someone is there to remind you of the law, makes it a bit more powerful. And it's funny, I was listening to a sermon about this passage, and at the same time, he hit the same illustration that I'm about to make. The same thing was happening to me as happened to this guy. It was interesting. So, sometimes I speed. I know, it's a confession. I speed sometimes when I'm driving. I go about 10 over. So if it's 60, I sometimes go 70. If it's 80, I sometimes go 90. If it's 100, I go 110. I know you can talk to me after. It's real bad. But this week as I was driving, I saw an officer on the side of the road with his radar gun out, pointing his gun at me, his radar gun. And all of a sudden, I was very, very aware of the law. And 10 over is no longer acceptable for me. I stepped on the brakes. I checked my shirt. Am I doing okay? What's going on here? Because I knew that it's no longer acceptable to go 10 over the law. See, when there's a person nearby that's reminding you of the law, man, how your thoughts change, how your heart changes. I read this in a commentary. It says, God's change in the system is a simple one. He takes the laws which express righteousness and puts them not in external commandments, but on the inner tablets of the mind and the heart. And this change in the system makes you more aware of God's standards. And as you're aware of that standard, and you understand the sacrifice that Jesus made for you, your desire now is not for yourself, but it's desire to follow Jesus in an act of devotion to him. True change comes as a result of what's written in your heart. It comes from inside of you. God put his laws inside of us. The Spirit of God brings an understanding of God's laws, and he's given you the strength through his Spirit to live out those laws. And many of people I talk to, whether I'm sharing Jesus with them or I'm talking about God, sometimes they have this person in their mind and they think, I could never live up to that person. I could never be like that person. They're just so holy. They're so good all the time. I could never be like that. And they're right. They can't be like that. But the power of the Holy Spirit at work in your life changes how you think, changes how you feel. Your desires change because God's law is in you and it's working in you. It's not simply something you read and you try to live up to it. It's something God does in you and through you. Well, verse 11, it shows us the goal of the new covenant. It says this, none of them shall teach his neighbor and none his brother, saying, know the Lord, for all shall know me, from the least of them to the greatest of them. It's the goal. All people will know God. That's the goal. And I'm not just talking about a casual knowing. This is deep, life-changing knowledge of God, where you know that you know that you know that God is real and God is true, and that knowledge brings you into such a close relationship with God, where you've confessed your sins to him and you're walking in God's grace. That's relationship. And John 17:3 says, "And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you've sent." The word know in John's gospel is the same one used here in Hebrews. The word know speaks of this deep relationship with God. And this is the goal of the new covenant, to bring people into relationship with God. The old covenant was weak because the people were weak. They didn't follow it. Therefore, they were out of relationship with God. And this is saying that all people, least to the greatest of people, will be able to know God. It doesn't matter who you are, what you've done or haven't done, all will be able to know God. And I think this verse is speaking future tense, because he's saying all people will know. It's pointing to the day that when all the earth will know God. Isaiah 11 prophesies about it. The lion and the lamb and the kids playing by the viper nest or whatever it is. You can read it. It's awesome. It talks about this day when all people will know God. And what does knowing God bring? Verse 12. "For I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and their lawless deeds I will remember no more." Praise God. The new covenant brings forgiveness, brings mercy. God says he won't remember all the sins, all the bad things you've done physically, all the awful things that you've thought about, all the wicked things you've felt in your heart will be remembered no more. Now, I don't know about you guys. Are you forgetful? Do you forget things sometimes? I had my brother send me a text yesterday, and he asked me if I remember this guy that we both worked with from a grocery store, and I couldn't remember him. I had no clues, totally out of my memory. I couldn't bring him back into it at all. And so I asked the question, how will God not remember? Like, I'm a man, of course I can forget. If God is God, then surely he can remember. Is God too old? Like, is his memory starting to fail that he's going to forget all these sins? Like, is he just going to forget? Not at all. God chooses not to remember because of the sacrifice Jesus Christ did. It's done. It's gone. It's out of his mind. The deal has been done. Therefore, it's out. He's not going to recall it. It's not going to come back into his memory. He's not going to hold it against you. He looks at you and sees the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. And he says, you're forgiven. And I'm so happy about that. Praise Jesus. Such a great feeling. And this is the benefit of the new covenant. The sacrifice was perfect and complete, and it deals with your sins forever, and it says God won't remember them. You see, under the old covenant, sins were not taken away. Under the old covenant, they weren't taken away. They were covered up. They were just covered. When we get to Hebrews 10, we'll see that. It says, it's not possible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. There was a reminder in the Old Testament of your sins all the time because there's sacrifices going on. And once a year, there's this big annual feast and reminder of the Day of Atonement of all the sins of the people. But this says under the new covenant, God will not remember your sins because of the sacrifice of Jesus. Now, I had a question about this passage where it says, I will be merciful. Wasn't God merciful before the new covenant? Didn't he show mercy before? Like, after the new covenant has come, is God like, finally, now I can show some mercy. Finally, the new covenant has come in because I've been showing anger and wrath all these years, and finally, I can show some mercy. No, that's not what he's saying. God has always been gracious and always been merciful. You can see it throughout the Old Testament. It's abundant. And I think here in Hebrews, God's simply declaring his character, his heart for people. This is what he wants to do. He wants to be merciful. This is what he desires to show all people. This is how God has always been. He's always been merciful. You can read it in the Old Testament countless times where God shows mercy, not because someone did the proper sacrifice or followed the law perfectly, but simply because they asked him for mercy. And what does God do? He shows mercy. Their heart was in a soft place, and they called out to God for mercy, and God shows mercy. This is his true character. This is God's nature, to be merciful. And God's character hasn't changed, but the emphasis of this passage is that when you believe in Jesus Christ and you accept the new covenant, your sins, past, present, future, will be forgotten. God will show mercy. Well, verse 13 says, in that he says, a new covenant. He has made the first obsolete. Now, what is becoming obsolete and growing old is ready to vanish away. The author's reiterating for these Jewish believers that it's done. The old covenant is done. Don't go back to sacrifice. Don't go back to the old way of doing things. There's a new covenant. You don't need to go back there. It's an inferior covenant, and it's ready to vanish away. It'll be gone. Now, it's interesting, because a few years after this letter was written, they think this letter was written in AD 64. What happened in AD 70? The temple was destroyed, and sacrifices stopped. And so God maybe took care of it another way. It's interesting. It's one of those cool things. And so the author is trying to establish with these Jewish believers, don't go back to the old way. Don't go back to the old way of doing things. There's a new way, and it's far better. Well, how about us? You see, these Jewish believers that the author's writing to, they're struggling. They're struggling with the temptation or the thoughts to go back to an old system, to go back to an old way, because maybe it's more comfortable. And the author's been making this point that Jesus is greater. He's greater than the old way. The old way is no good, so stay the course with Jesus. But how does that apply to you? Well, turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. It's a wonderful passage. It says this, 2 Corinthians 5, verse 17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. See, when you became a Christian, you received the Holy Spirit. When you received the Holy Spirit in your life, the Bible says you became a new creation in Christ. And this verse says, old things have passed away. And some of us, we can be tempted, like these Jewish believers, to go back to the old way. Or to go back to that old way of doing things, or things that you're holding on to from the past. Perhaps dabbling in sin. Maybe you used to do it frequently before you were saved. And God's law inside of you has been reminding you, hey, stop that. That's the old way. You don't need to do that. There's a better way here. Cut that out. The Holy Spirit is there to help you stop that sin. And perhaps you aren't trusting God's promises for your life. And the old you is springing up through a tough situation, and you're seeing this difficult situation, you're thinking, I'm just going to fix this. That's how I do it in the past, and that's how I'm going to do it now. I'm going to fix this thing myself. And what I usually find is that I make things worse when I try to fix things. But God makes them better when I surrender them to Him, when I leave them in His hands. Because God's promises are strong, they're secure, and they're for you. Perhaps there's a step of faith that's been on your heart for a little while, and you're wondering, how's this going to happen? And the old you, you would never step out in faith. You'd never do anything like that. The old you is stuck in this old place. But the Holy Spirit inside of you is saying, hey, go for it. Do this. Do this. Listen and do it. Christian, you have God's law written on your heart and your mind. Don't ignore it. Follow it. Do it. Put it into practice. See, the Holy Spirit was given as a guarantee to you, and the nudge that you feel in your heart, the conviction you get, is the Holy Spirit telling you it's time to move on from those old ways. It's time to move into better ways. It's not a part of your nature anymore. There's a better way because you belong to the new covenant.